Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
How are you?
Good.
Okay, as I was saying yesterday, what we are doing, and actually not just for this particular kind of ministry, but whenever we serve the Lord, there should always be a combination of both spirit and system or skills. Amen? As I said, even if you have the nicest car, without a gasoline, you won't reach anything. Okay? So we need the power of God so that our labors will bear fruit. But at the same time, we need to know what we have to do. Amen? Yeah. Okay, that's why, again, this evening, we're going to talk about, the first part, we're going to talk about the heart of this vision, the spirit of what we are doing. Then later, I'm going to talk about the system. Okay, and at the end, on our third session, I'm going to talk about how to apply this in your local church. Okay, was excited about this?
Amen.
Hello.
Hello. Okay.
So let's start with this one. Let's start with the spirit of the vision. Let's start with the heart of the vision. As I was saying, we believe in revival, and we are living in revival. This is very much happening, not just in the Philippines, but in many countries. We have been witnessing all this, and we are so excited about what God is going to do more in many nations. And I am excited about what God is going to do here in Sydney. Amen?
Amen.
Come on, do you believe that God is not yet done with your church?
Yes.
Well, let me just share this short testimony to you. I am now pastoring a 63-year-old church. And please, please, don't you ever think that I am the founder of the church. I am just 23. Okay? Okay, I am not. No, actually, we lost count on how many pastors have been to the church already. No, and of course, I'm sharing this with you to number one, to give glory to the Lord. No, and at the same time, to show you, show pastors and churches that it doesn't really matter what situation your church is in right now, because God is able to revive any kind of church.
Amen.
Our church is an old church, obviously. And it was a dying church before. Okay? That's why when I talk about revival, I know what I am talking about, because we have experienced it. And it is not by the power of any man, it is of course by the power of God.
No?
When I arrive at the church, we have 35 people, no? 30, I guess 30, no? If I say 40, I'll be lying. So yeah, it's about 30 to 35 people. We have more anniversary than members. Is that your story too, no? More anniversary than people, okay? So that's our story. And of course, our transition is not as fast as the transition of other churches, because this is an old one. Okay, but when I came there, of course, I did not know G12 yet during that time. It was 45-year-old church with 35 members. So we have we still lack 10 members for for the year and the number of people to be equal. Okay, but anyway, I came there with with some dreams, with aspiration that I was fresh graduate from the seminary during that time. Okay, I had my Bible studies, and then I proceeded to the seminary for my master's in theology. Since I was a fresh grad, I was also kind of idealistic. Okay, so I was thinking that, okay, the people in this community will learn that there's a cute pastor here, and they will be coming, okay, and they would love to listen to me. Okay, of course, I'm exaggerating, but I had some illusions during that time. But the first year passed, and I got frustrated. Nothing seemed to be happening much, or actually, little things. there are some, but it's not really satisfying. And I am beginning, and even the leaders of the church are beginning to feel some frustration. Okay, and you know, during that time, I began to really seek the Lord. No? I prayed, I fasted, no, I kneeled I knelt before God in various places of our sanctuary, of our church. So sometimes I knelt inside the church, sometimes beside the washroom, no? Sometimes at the open area, within the compound of the church. I've been praying, I've been fasting. That's why, you know what? I believe that G12 is an answer to my prayer and fasting. Amen. My prayer was, Lord, please revive this church so that other old churches will realize that it is not about the age of the church. That regardless of the age, if you want to revive a church, you can still revive it. Do you agree with me in that?
Amen.
So that was my prayer. And also part of my prayer was, Lord, I do not want to be taken as, I do not want our church to be taken as just one of the religious groups in this place. Because we are not just one of these religious groups. We are your people. We are your church.
Yeah.
So please revive this church.
Yeah. Yes.
I also asked the Lord, I don't want to be considered as just one of the pastors. There are pastors, there are many priests, there are many religious leaders in our country. So I prayed, Lord, I don't want to be seen as just one of those religious leaders. Because I am not just like those people. I am your man. I said to the Lord, I am your man, and so please, Lord, do something in this church. And praise the Lord. Really, He is a God of revival.
Amen.
Amen. So what happened next is, of course, quite a long story. As I've said, we had quite a long transition because of the history of the church, because of the traditions of the church. But to sum it up, truly, God has revived the church. No? And then now we are a growing, vibrant church in the heart of our city. Okay, it's within Metro Manila. And of course, all glory to the Lord.
Amen.
And that's why I've said earlier, G12 is an answer to my prayer. Because when I ask the Lord, Lord, please revive this church. Please do something in this church. The Lord led me to do something for the church.
Amen.
So please, do not entrust everything to the Lord. Okay? Sometimes you have to, I guess sometimes you have to decrease your faith. What I mean is, because sometimes we have so much faith that we leave everything to the Lord. Of course, I'm a bit exaggerating here, no? But my point is, we expect the Lord to do everything. Lord, please move in my church. And the Lord says to you, move in your church. Okay? Lord, please visit the new believers. And the Lord says, why me? Visit them. Hello?
Yeah.
Because when you ask something from the Lord, when you ask for revival, His answer will be for you to do something also.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Hello, amen?
Amen?
When we ask something to happen in our respective ministries, we must also open ourselves so that God can use us.
Amen.
Okay? We must also make ourselves available so that we will do whatever God wants us to do. Amen? Our church is not that big yet, no? And we have big dreams, we have big visions, and we are believing the Lord in this. No? Of course, we have more than 1,000 in our cell groups, in our discipleship groups. No, but our Sunday service attendance reaches up to 800. No? Sometimes it goes down, but that's our regular Sunday service attendance. Not that big yet compared to my fellow pastors there. No? But again, I'm sharing this with you. Why? Because ours is a story of revival.
Yeah.
And God can revive any church. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen.
Okay, of course, Australia may have a long history of Christianity, just like the Philippines.
Yeah.
Okay. Of course, we were conquered by the Spaniards. And of course, we brought Catholic Christianity. And then the Americans came. They brought Protestant Christianity, Biblical Christianity. So Biblical Christianity in the Philippines is more than 100 years also. No? And what's important there is that the Lord is now awakening, or is now bringing spiritual awakening in the lives of so many Filipinos.
Amen?
Amen. So this country has a long history of Christianity also, but we must believe that God is a God of revival.
Yes.
God is not yet done in this country, in this city, and in our churches.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
We believe God in that. Come on, we believe God. So we do not come here to just give some information or to just instruct. We come here to impart, no? Because we believe that God has given us a new fire, a fire of revival, and God has given us the anointing to bear fruit for Him, and that's what we are bringing to various nations. Okay, so let us believe that we are not gathering here so that we will hear something new. No, we are gathering here so that something new will happen in our churches.
Amen.
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 Okay, come on. Tap your neighbor. Come on, tell your neighbor something's going to happen. Amen.
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 Okay, let me start with this again. We're going to the heart of the things that we are doing. No? Now, when we say, what's the heart of this G12 thing? It's actually loving God and loving people. Okay, loving God and loving people. We do the things that we do because we love God and we love people. Now, we want us to focus on loving people. Please open your Bibles in Isaiah 49, verse 18 to 20. Isaiah 49, verse 18 to 20. Okay, please read it aloud with me. Lift up your eyes around and see. They all gather, they come to you. As I live, declares the Lord, you shall put them all on as an ornament. Come on, can you say that last word aloud? Ornament. What is an ornament? Come on, what is an ornament? Of course, it could be jewelry, right?
Yeah.
Right? Okay, ornaments are usually worn to enhance one's looks. Right?
Yeah.
Hello?
Yes.
To make someone look more beautiful or look more handsome, that's why we use ornaments. As I've said, it could be jewelry like bracelets. Right? Can you look at your neighbor and answer, are you a bracelet? Answer, why? Why?
Why?
Because I always want you in my arms. Okay? Or it could be necklaces with beautiful pendants. Right? Okay, ask your neighbor, please. No? Are you a pendant? Answer, why? Because you are so near my heart. Okay, and like eyeglasses, I do not want to take you off my eyes. Okay, these are ornaments, right? Right. Okay, earrings and many other things. And many ornaments now are not just jewelries. Okay, sometimes they are somewhat inside the body. No, like. Contact lenses, right? Try one. Try color red. It may look very beautiful. What else? Others are using braces, no? Others are using it actually as an ornament, not necessarily because there's something to be corrected in their teeth, but they use it as ornaments. Okay. What else? Some ornaments are more natural than others, like dimples, right? Three dimples, one here, okay? Or wrinkles, wrinkles or ornament, or pimples, okay? Okay, but of course, when we say ornaments, it is worn to enhance one's looks, right?
Yeah.
Okay, now in this verse, it says here, you shall bind them on as a bride. Thus, so in this prophecy, the Lord gave us a picture of a bride who must wear an ornament, right? As you know, a woman who is about to get married or a woman who is a bride must look beautiful,
yeah.
Right? Not just in the sight of the groom, but even in the sight, of course, of the visitors, right?
Yeah.
So it's very normal that a bride wants to look her best during the time of her wedding. Hello?
Yeah.
Okay, I remember my first pastor, my first lady pastor. I was a new believer, and she was about to get married. And you know what? And I really saw this. This is really observable, no? Because maybe a week before, her wedding, she jumped. For a day. So she, yeah, she went jogging. Just for a day. Okay, as if it would, make any difference. About a week before the wedding. Why is that? Because it is normal for a bride to look, to want to look beautiful. Right? Okay. Now, in this case, of course, this is Old Testament passage. So the Lord here is talking about Jerusalem. Okay? And in the history of Israel, we all know that because of their hard-heartedness, the Lord has punished them and led them to and brought them to exile. Right?
Yeah.
So they were dispersed somewhere in Egypt, and of course, most of them were in Babylon, part of Iraq, right? Mostly part of Iraq right now, and Iran, Persia. Okay, so most Israelites were in those nations during this time. So it was 70 years of captivity, remember?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, now because of the grace of the Lord, and He also promised through the prophets that although they have been taken as captives, they will eventually come back to their own land. Okay, so this is the prophecy here. And the Lord said, you will wear them as ornaments and as a bride. Thus, now of course, the bride that is being referred to here again is the nation of Israel, or is Jerusalem. Okay? But in our case, in the New Testament, we all know that when the Lord speaks of a bride, He is referring to what? Come on, come on. Okay, the first night we talk about the church as the body of Christ. But we all know that the church also is the bride of Christ.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
Now, if we are going to consider as the bride of Christ, of course, okay, let me just clarify that we all belong to this universal bride of Christ. Okay? Our church in Manila, your church here, other churches from other parts of the world, we all compose the bride of Christ. That's the universal bride of Christ. Amen?
Yeah.
But in our certain localities, in the places where the Lord has placed your church, that church there is a representation of the bride of Christ. Okay? Am I being clear? Okay? So our church in the Philippines is a representation of the bride of Christ there. Your church here, this particular church, his story, is a representation of the bride of Christ in this particular place. Amen? Okay? In every church that you came from, that church is a representation of the bride of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? So now, as a representation of the bride of Christ, my question is this. What is the ornament of your church? Or, to put it another way, what do you think makes your church beautiful in the sight of the Lord? Hello? Hello? Have you ever considered that? No? If ever the Lord looks at your church, wow, I love this church. This church is so beautiful. No? And what could be the reason? Okay, have you ever thought of the ornament of your church? Well, there are many kinds of ornaments, right? Other churches are really fond of having so many programs, right? So your ornament could be your programs. Okay? And there's nothing wrong with having programs. Right? It's just that there are so many churches who really live for the programs. Okay? And you know, for instance, every month they have a special program. Okay? Of course, December, so it's Christmas party. January, so it's party. February, what? Valentine's party? No? What on March? I don't know year. Okay? So, there could be many programs. Okay? And of course, one of the most exciting programs of the church is the anniversary, right?
Yeah.
Right? In anniversary, you become a mega church. Right? And your church is revived. Okay? Yeah. So they love anniversaries. That's why other churches do not just celebrate anniversaries. They celebrate mansary. Pixary, maybe. Why not Pixary? So that every week the church is on fire. Hello? Yeah, there's nothing wrong with programs. But is this the one that we're going to present to the Lord someday? Lord, look at our programs. Aren't we a very beautiful church? Okay? Yeah, it could be programs. Other churches could be their properties. Right? Lord, we have bought this property. Of course, we need buildings. Right? But is this the one that we're going to present to the Lord someday? It could be your location. Right? The place where you are in. Oh, our place is very strategic. We're in the middle of the highway. Everyone passes on through it. What is that? Is that our, is that our ornament before the Lord? Okay. Wow, this church is so powerful. Yeah, that's also an asset, right? Okay. There's so much power in this church. The lame see, the blind walk. No, and you know what? Of course, I believe in miracles. The Lord does miracles, even in our church. But in the first place, it is the Lord who heals the sick, right?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. So what else? Other churches consider their past to be their ornament. Huh? Yeah. Do you have historical members? No, in the past. During the time of like that, right? So you always go back to the past, to the history. Of course, we praise God for our past. We are not to throw away our past. Amen? We have to be grateful of what the Lord has done in the past. But we cannot live in the past. Amen? Okay? Because God is not confined in the past. Amen? Okay? Others consider their pastor as their asset. We have the most handsome pastor on earth. Members, come on, say amen, amen. Hey, your pastors are here. Okay? Yeah, so we can consider many things to be our assets, right? Yeah. To be our ornaments. But obviously, in here, the Lord is not talking about the nation as in as geographical, right? It's not about the property there, no? It's not about the buildings. It's not about other things. But when the Lord said, they all gather, they come to you, no? You will wear them all as an ornament. Who or what is the Lord referring to as ornaments? What the Lord is referring to as ornaments? Okay? It's about people. Come on, guys, say that aloud. People.
People.
Come on, people.
People.
It's the people, right? So, as a church, okay, like in my church, what am I going to present to the Lord? Now, what I suppose to be the asset of this church? What makes this church beautiful in the sight of the Lord? It is the people. Because we all know that the church is not the building, in the first place, it's the people.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen?
The body of Christ is not the building, it's the people. Okay? So the asset of the church, the ornament of the church should always be the people. I'm talking about this because as churches, we really have to have a heart for people. Amen?
Amen.
Okay? So let's just continue reading. In verse 19, so the Lord said, okay, you will put him on as an ornament, no? In verse 19, and okay, let's continue reading. Okay, surely your ways and your desolate places and your devastated land, now surely now you will be too narrow for your inhabitants. Obviously, it's the people, inhabitants.
Yeah.
Right? No? And those who swallowed you up will be far away, your conquerors before. Verse 20. No? The children, obviously, the people again. The children of your bereavement. Okay, you lost these people, no? But time will come when they will say in your ears, the place is too narrow for me, make room for me to dwell in. Wow, that's a very beautiful problem, right? Time will come when your people will come to you and say, this place is too narrow for us, give us more space. Hello, do you want that, Okay, what kind of problem do you want in your church, okay? Nothing to sit on or no one to sit. Hello? No chair or no butt. Okay? Of course, no? In this case, before, it's too desolate. The space is too wide. No? And sometimes I pity some spaces in the church, no? Oh, this chair is those desolate chair, no? This chair is a lonely chair, no? So next time in your church, can you pray for that chair, Lord, please? Next time, please fill this chair, no? I don't want it to remain desolate. Hello? There are desolate spaces in the church. There are desolate chairs. No? But you know what? When the Lord brings revival in our church, that could be the story. This place is too narrow for us. Bring us more space to live in. Amen?
Amen.
Come on, do you want that to be the story of your church? Okay? So again, the Lord here is talking of people as ornaments. So as church leaders, we should also have that kind of mindset. Okay? What should be the asset of this church? Okay? It should be the people. We exist for the people. Amen?
Amen.
Because you know what? If the Lord, just think about this, no? If we think that the Lord has called us and formed a church in our place just for us to worship together, no? You know what? If that's just the intention of the Lord, He can just bring us directly to heaven. Right? We don't need to stay here on earth.
Yeah.
Amen? Because if He only wants worship. Mm. Amen?
Amen?
Why? Our worship is much better and of course, the purest kind of worship we can give to God in heaven. Hello?
Yeah.
So why are we still here on earth? Of course, we believe that we are being formed into Christ likeness. Of course. No? But again, no. One of the major things there, why God has left us here on earth is for us to win other people.
Amen.
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 Amen. So as churches, please let us not spend all of our times in doing the things on earth which we can also do in heaven.
Amen.
Okay. So let us also spend much time in doing things that we cannot no longer do in heaven. And what is that? Okay? Of course, worship we can still do in heaven.
Amen.
Hello?
Yeah.
Do you agree with me?
Yeah.
Right? Okay, so what is it that we can do on earth that we can no more do in heaven? It is winning the lost and making disciples.
Amen.
Hello?
Amen.
Hello? Or unless you are still thinking of winning Judas back to the Lord, no? When you get to the afterlife. No, of course you cannot decide. I'm going to disciple people. No, of course you cannot. We cannot do that anymore. So it is bringing people to the Lord while we are still here on earth.
Amen.
Amen. That we can no more do in eternity. So please let us do it here while we are still here. Amen.
Amen.
So what should be the ornament of the church?
The people.
So what do we value in the church? Of course, we value godliness. We value worship. But we should also value people. Amen.
Amen.
It's very important that we develop hearts for people. So you might be thinking that, so Pastor, for as long as we have people, so is that enough? Okay. It's not just about having people. Of course, when the Lord gave this prophecy, particularly in Ezekiel 36, verse 26, I guess, the Lord said, I'm going to give you a new heart. I will replace the heart of stone with the heart of flesh. I will remove the old spirit. I'm going to give you a new spirit. Remember?
Yeah.
Okay? So when the Lord promised revival to Israel, He was not just promising about people coming back, no? But He was promising new people, new kinds of people.
Amen.
Amen.
So when we talk about people in our churches, we are not just talking about having people. We are talking about quality people.
Amen.
Okay? That's why I don't know about you. I am praying, and my vision is this, that we may have multitudes of genuine disciples. I'm not praying for members. I'm praying for disciples.
Amen.
Okay? Because God is not just looking for people who will just attend churches. God is looking for people who will truly be committed to follow Him.
Amen.
And living righteous lives. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So this is about quality people. Okay, and we might say, yeah, Pastor, we have people, and we have good people, we have quality people. So is that all? No. Why? Because it should not just be quality people, but in this passage, we can say that God is also looking for plenty of people. Hello?
Yeah.
Plenty of people. Just consider this verse. No, this place is too narrow. Give us more space to live in. So when the Lord promised revival, He said, I'm going to give you a new heart. But at the same time, you will be filled with people again. Okay? Because when there's the true revival, there's not just choir, the people are not just in love with the Lord, the people are not just leading righteous lives, the people are also bringing more people to the Lord. Amen. There's a picture of revival there. Amen. Hello? Amen. Okay, so this is about more people, more and more people coming to the Lord. Okay, you know what? This should come from the heart that we want people to be saved, and we want people to be the kind of individuals that God wants them to be. Amen. Okay, so it should be quality people and plenty of people. Now, pastors, now leaders, do you agree with me that because of this, the things that we do in the church should result to bringing people to the Lord?
Yes.
Hello? Hello? Okay? That we should do more, that will lead people to Jesus Christ. Do you agree with me on that?
Yes.
Okay? Hello? Okay? That we should think more of, okay, we're going to do this, but will it bring people to the Lord? I'm not saying that we do everything like that, no? But we must think of more events, more actions that will lead more people to the Lord, because God is pleased whenever someone is brought to Him.
Amen.
Amen? Amen? I don't know if you heard about this story. There was this one pastor, and he has a member in the church who was a reckless driver. You know what? This driver was so reckless that he drives 140 kilometers per hour. Backwards. That's fast. Okay. And one time, because they belong to one church, they were riding together. The reckless driver was driving, and the pastor was the passenger. And again, he was driving so fast. And then suddenly, bam! They made an accident, and they both died on spot. And you know, they just woke up in the afterlife, okay? And there in the afterlife, they were facing the Lord, okay? And of course, the eternal or the final rewarding will be when the Lord Jesus Christ comes again, right?
Yeah.
But in heaven, there will be an initial reward. And the initial reward will be the kind of house that you will live in. So it depends on the what you have done for the Lord while you were on earth. Okay, so the driver was called first because his surname starts in A. It's alphabetical. So he was called, and he was shown the picture, okay, in PowerPoint. He was shown the kind of mansion that he's going to live in while in heaven. Wow. It's so beautiful, it's so big, no? And it's in the prime area of heaven.
Wow.
Oh, in the highest class
area,
of heaven. No? So of course, the driver was so excited, and the pastor who was behind him with letter B in his surname, no? So he got so excited too, and he thought, wow, if this driver who was speaking, he's like driving very fast, recklessly, how much more I? I spent almost all of my time serving the Lord, preaching His word. You know? So when he was called, with much excitement, he awaited for the PowerPoint of his house. But you know what? When he saw his house, he got frustrated. Yeah, nothing's ugly in heaven. Yeah, but it's not as beautiful as the house of the reckless driver. So he got sad. No, and he couldn't contain his sadness, so he asked the Lord, it's not that I'm complaining, but he just asked something, and the Lord said, what is it, my son? Lord, I just noticed that you just gave me this little house in heaven, but the one that you've given to, you know, that's my driver, that's my church member, who was not discipled in driving. No? And all he did was to drive recklessly, and yet you gave him this much reward. Actually, it's even the reason why I'm here today. Okay? And while I spent all of my time preaching your word, and yet I received this little reward. Isn't it unfair, Lord? And the Lord said, my son, I'm not being unfair to any one of you. it's like this, no? I am looking at the result of your labor. You know what? It's because when you speak, everyone fall asleep. But when this driver drives, everyone comes to me and pray. Lord, please protect us. Lord, please, I want to stay alive, Lord, and I'll change. Okay? Lord, please, please, please. Oh, I'm saying this so that you will not fall asleep when every time your pastor is speaking. Amen? Amen? Hello? Amen.
Amen.
Please have pity on us pastors. Okay? This pastor's man. So don't fall asleep. Okay? But do you agree with me? This is very important. Regardless of our position in the church, we have this common function. And the function is to bring people to the Lord. Amen?
Amen?
Okay? So what do we do? What do we do now? No? If we consider people to be ornaments, number one, love people. Love people. Okay? Ornaments. Okay? So, what do we do? Come on, come on. What do we do again? Love people. Okay? We should love people. Okay? Love first. Okay? So, the Lord said, in Mark 12, okay, the first two commandments, the greatest commandments, love the Lord your God with all you have, with all your soul. Amen. Okay? And what's next? Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Okay? That should be the kind of heart that we have as we serve the Lord, as we follow the Lord as believers. Amen? For us to have a big heart for people. Now, how is that? How do I love people like I love myself? Okay? Consider this. I learned that sociologists categorize people in three. Okay? What are these three categories? Number one is what they call the people. Who are the people? These are the people that you love, the people that you respect, the people that you care about. You will not just do anything or say anything without considering the feelings or the perspective of these people. Okay? So the people. The second category, according to sociologists, is the machine people. These are the people that you may not love, okay? But you need them. That's why machine. Okay? And the third category is the landscape people. What's the landscape people? These are the people that you may not love. You do not need them. They just happen to be there. Just part of the view. That's why landscape. Okay? So when we say loving others as we love ourselves, it should be that we will have that perspective of people as people. Amen? Okay? That if I look at myself this way, I know that when I have a problem, this is what I feel. I know that when I'm going through circumstances like this, of course, this is what was going on in my mind. No? So if this is me, then that could also be what's happening in the inside of people. Amen? Yeah. If I need the Lord, then the Lord, then these people also needs the Lord. Amen?
Yeah.
Okay? So, but the problem here is that we are not like that. Okay? We do not consider others to be people. Many of them are machine and mostly are what?
Landscape.
Of course, landscape people. Okay. Okay, that's normal. But what do we do? We cannot possibly do this to everyone, by the way. But how about at least to those people who are nearest us? To the people who are within our circle of influence? To the people who are closest to us? What do we do to them? Promote them. Come on, say it aloud. Promote.
Promote.
Promote from what? Promote them from being landscape people to becoming people. Promote them from just being machine people to becoming people. Amen? Because the truth is, we are surrounded by these kinds of people all our lives. Right? Okay? And actually, even us ourselves as individuals, we are like that to other people. Hello?
Yeah.
Like, okay, to my wife, hopefully, I am a people. Okay? Maybe to others, I'm just, okay, to the pilot of the airplane, then I'm just a machine, I'm just a passenger, right?
Yeah.
Hello?
Yes.
Okay? Or maybe to the airline, I'm a machine, no? But maybe to the flight stewardess, maybe I'm just a landscape. Hello?
Yes.
Right? Yes. So, that's normal. That's normal. So, what do we do? Okay? We should elevate people. We should promote people in our lives so that we will consider them, we will look at them as people. But the problem is this. We are so good not in promoting people. We are rather very good in demoting people. Hello. Right? Okay? So before, they're people. Now you're offended. They're now landscape. No? Actually not landscape, garbage of my eyes. Hello? Right? Okay? So we are so good in demoting people. Just consider this. Huh? When we were kids, like in the elementary, okay? So how do we regard our parents? Most likely, they're people. We're so close to them. Right?
Yeah.
Hello? Okay? And now when you were in high school or in college, what happened to our parents? The machine. Right? The one who gave the allowance. Right? Okay, now that we are independent, we have our own lives. What happened to many parents? Of course, not, if not all. But what happened to many parents? Many parents has become landscape. Does that happen? Yeah, a lot. But I'm sharing this with you because if ever that happens, if we are able to promote, to demote them, we can also do something to promote them again. Amen?
Yeah.
Even in the relationship of husband and wife, do you believe that this happens? Hello?
Yes.
Do you believe? No? In the first year of marriage, okay, imagine this. In the first year of marriage, the wife goes, just clearing her throat. and the husband panic and said, oh, sweetheart, oh, babe, oh, loves, oh, darling, no, honey, come on, I'm bringing you to the emergency room of this hospital. Okay. After 5 years of marriage, after 5 years, the wife goes, and the husband reacted, no? Hey, mommy, no? Will you drink some medicine? No one will take care of the children. So what happened? From people, now machine. About after 10 years, and the wife goes, oh. And the husband says, hey, will you stop barking like a dog? Demoted, right? Right? Okay. Let's take the other angle, okay? First year of marriage, the wife of the husband arrives from work, and the wife, of course, was so excited and said, oh, sweetheart, oh, you're sweaty. Come on, change your shirt. Oh, come on, I have prepared your favorite dinner. Come on, eat. Okay, why? First year of marriage. About 5 years, the wife comes from work, also sweaty. And the husband arrives from work, and the wife goes, where's your salary? So what happened? Okay, and after 10 years, the wife arrives, the husband arrives, no? And the wife would not even pay attention, no? And the husband would even ask, oh, okay, what's our food today? No? And, hey, don't disturb me, I'm just watching TV. Why is that? No, because we are good at demoting people.
Yeah.
But I have good news for you. If we can demote, we can also promote.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So what has happened to our relationships? What has happened to the people around us? Okay? Please promote them. Even in our churches, let's start with the people in our churches. Because sometimes we are so used to doing church, and the members, the worshippers there, just become landscape, or just become machine fighters. Right?
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah.
No, but why don't we start with our people? No, Lord, these are not machine people. These are not people. These are people.
Yeah.
I am the pastor. I am a leader of this church. I am a member of this church. Every individual in this church, I consider to be people.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen.
Let's start with that. Let's love our people. Amen? Let's expand. Let's ask God for a bigger heart. Lord, I do not want my heart to be to just contain my family, to just contain my church members. Lord, I want my heart to be bigger. Please enlarge my heart spiritually. No?
Yeah.
Please enlarge my heart so I can accommodate more people in my life.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
They love people. Come on, tell your neighbor, love people.
Okay.
Let us love more people. Amen? Okay? Because, yeah, how can you consider them to be ornaments? Yeah, in the sight of God, they are already ornaments. But in our case, in our eyes, how do we consider them ornaments if we do not truly value them?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So every believer in the church must be taken as precious. Okay, this person is valuable in the sight of God. Every believer, everyone that we have shared the gospel to and who has placed his faith in the Lord Jesus, we must consider that person a very valuable person in the sight of God. An ornament. Amen?
Amen.
So let's start with that. Lord, give me heart for people. No, love people. Amen. And secondly, love or lead people. Lead people. Okay? There was a mistake with the PowerPoint. Okay? So it should be love people. And number two, lead
people.
Okay? Lead people. So what do we do? Okay. We love people. We value them. So what's next? It's not enough to be compassionate. Amen?
Yeah.
It's not enough to have pity on people, no? To sympathize or even empathize with people. No? We should also exert efforts to lead them.
Yeah.
What do I mean by leading people? Number one, lead them to Christ. Hello? Lead them to
Christ.
And when we say lead them to Christ, that's why we emphasize in our churches evangelism. Soul winning. Amen.
Amen.
It starts with the heart. Lord, I love people. I want them to be saved. It's not just I want my church to grow. I want myself to increase in number. No. It should start with, Lord, these people need you. I want them to be saved.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So, because we want them to be saved, so what do? Let us lead them to Jesus Christ. No, by evangelism. No. Now, again, like in the Philippines, we are living in a predominantly Christian country. So sometimes when we talk about the gospel, we all know that it is also familiar to the people around us. Amen?
Yep.
It's familiar to us. It's familiar. Or the people around you, they're familiar with the gospel. No, just like they are in the Philippines.
Yeah.
Okay? There's this much familiarity.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay? Because when we say evangelism, of course, obviously, it came from the word evangel, which in Greek is euangelion, okay? Which means euangelion means gospel or good news, right? And when you say good news, of course, obviously, it's a news. And every news has a content. Have you ever read a news without content? Headlines. Blank. No, when you say it's a news, it has content. So what's the content of this good news? The content is this. The Lord is Jesus Christ is God who became man. He died on the cross, okay, buried, and on the third day, he rose again. Amen?
Amen?
So that's the content. Now my question is, then Pastor, when do we still need to share the gospel or evangelize? Isn't it that the people already know the content of the gospel? Yeah, most people in this country already knew the content of the gospel. But you know what? It is not about them knowing the content. That's why we share the gospel. It is about them responding properly to the gospel. Because every news requires an appropriate response. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. Okay? When you receive bad news, what's the appropriate response? Yeah, I like it, baby. Of course, no. No. If it's bad news, no. You are sad, right? If it's good news, will you become sad? Of course, no. That's inappropriate, right? But that's the problem with so many people around us. They know the good news, but they do not know how to react to it. They do not know the proper response to the gospel. Okay, so we evangelize so that people can properly respond to the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Like in the Philippines, what's the response of the people? No, when they hear of the gospel, no, Jesus Christ became man. He was born. No, Merry Christmas. So that's the response.
Yeah.
Right? It's how we Christmas party. Jesus died on the cross. Let's not eat pork. Jesus rose again, swimming. Hello? It's holiday, right? Okay. That's how they respond. Of course, obviously, I'm exaggerating. Yeah, but people know the gospel. They do not just know how to respond to it. What's the proper response to the gospel? Okay, Acts 20, verse 21. Acts 20, verse 21. Repentance toward God and faith in Jesus Christ. Okay? Two sides. Repentance and faith. Acts 20, verse 21. That's very clear there. The Apostle Paul said, this is what we preach to the Jews and to the Greeks alike, to all kinds of people. This is what we preach, that they should repent toward God and put their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So whenever we share the gospel, whenever we evangelize, what are we aiming for? We are aiming for repentance and faith. Amen?
Amen.
Okay? That we want these people to truly recognize themselves as sinners, to repent, and to place their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's evangelism. Amen? Please, do not just aim for PRC, prayer to receive Christ. No? We should understand the gospel. Okay? It is not the PRC that saves, it is the gospel. I am not ashamed of the gospel because it is the power of God for salvation of those who believe.
Amen?
Amen. Amen. So, there must be a clear presentation of the gospel. And of course, the proper response on the part of the person who hears the gospel.
Yeah.
Amen? Amen? So when I say lead people, let's lead people to Christ through evangelism. Okay? But secondly, when I say lead people, let us lead people to Christ-likeness. Hello? And that is called discipleship. Hello?
Yeah.
Right? Lead people to Christ, evangelism. Lead people to Christ-likeness, discipleship. Amen? Why? Again, because the Lord is not just looking for people to be added to His church. He wants plenty of people to be saved, but He also wants quality people. That's why we disciple them. That's why in so many churches now in the Philippines, okay, we are emphasizing evangelism, but we are also emphasizing discipleship. Okay, this person got saved. Now he's a believer in the Lord. What do we do next? Okay, we do our best to preserve that person so that the person will continue in the Lord, but will not just continue in the Lord, but to be molded in the image of the Lord so that that person will grow in his or her faith, so that that person will become more like the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay? So, we are for discipleship. Amen? We do not just want to help people get saved. We also want people to live according to how God wants them to live.
Yeah.
Okay? So, lead people. Amen? So that our church will be full of people who are ornaments of the Lord. Amen? Okay? So, heart for people. So, can we have that mindset? Can we have that thinking? Okay, Lord, you have given me a church. But the asset of this church, of course, Lord, first and foremost, because you are with us, is the number one, right? Okay, that's the first commandment. No, it's about the Lord. We love the Lord. But secondly, it's not about the things that we have. It's not just about the things that we do. Okay, it's about the people in the church.
Yeah.
I hope that we begin to see the church in a new light.
Amen.
Yes. Amen?
Yeah.
Can we just rise up? No, I mean, let's just come to the Lord and lift up this word to the Lord. Let's just come to the Lord now in prayer, asking for His life. Okay? Again, people are ornaments. Who are the real assets of our church? The people. Okay? God loves these people. Amen. Okay? Let's start with loving the people who we already have in our respective churches. But do not stop there. Let us love more people, so that we can help them to be the kind of individuals that God wants them to be.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yes.
So, let's just come to the Lord. Now, can we again place our hand on our heart? Come on. And let's ask the Lord. Lord, touch our hearts now. Touch our hearts now, Lord. Give us big heart for people. Lord, please enlarge our hearts so that we can accommodate more people. Give us compassion. Help us to feel what you feel. Lord, break our hearts with what breaks yours. Lord, give us your heart to the people around us. Help us, Lord, to be truly loving people. Lord, give us heart for the people that we already have in our lives, for our families, for our loved ones. Lord, give us a bigger heart for the people in our churches so that we may truly love them as your people because they are so precious to you. Help us them to truly love them. Lord, help us as well to love more people. The people in our community, the people in our school, in our workplaces. Lord, the people around us, give us more heart for them and please use us for them, Lord. Lord, we are making ourselves available to be a blessing to others. Particularly, Lord, to not just bless them in terms of their physical or material needs, but to bless them as well, Lord, more importantly, in their spiritual needs. Lord, use us. Come on, brother, sister, make yourself available. Tell the Lord, use me. Make me a blessing. Use us, Lord. Give us heart for people. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. We love you. Thank you for your so much love for us. Thank you, Lord. Change our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Amen. Okay. We're going to have a coffee break. No? 1 minute coffee break. So thank you so much. How many minutes? Sorry. 10 minutes coffee break.